If I were to say to you, right, as a follower of Jesus, what is something that you think you should be involved in or something that you should be doing? I'm sure that we'd get, I'm not going to do it to you, by the way, this morning. I'm just going to let you sit quietly on your own. I'm not going to make you say anything else out loud this morning. So you're all good. Don't worry. But I'm sure there'd be many things that we would say and lots of ideas that might come. But I reckon not too long, one thing that we would talk about is the fact that we as Christians feel we need to share the gospel, the truth of what we know for ourselves, to other people. I'm guessing that most of us that are Christians would recognize that that's something that we are called to do. That idea of sharing the good news that we know for ourselves. Now, if we're being honest with ourselves, most of us would probably say that, and then we'd kind of, I don't know, draw a breath and think, okay, so how do I do that? And what does that look like in the society that I live in today? Because I reckon that this idea of telling other people about Jesus is not always something that we as Christians find very easy. Sometimes it might feel a little bit daunting, a little bit difficult, a little bit tricky, maybe. And I guess most of us can only dream, well, maybe it'll freak us out this dream, I don't know, but most of us can only dream about arriving at a venue and speaking effectively to a crowd of people about Jesus and the difference that he's made in their life and the difference that he can make in the lives of those people who are listening to them. Maybe we would think, that's a nightmare for some of us, even standing up in front of a big crowd. But whatever, it's probably not something that we think is going to be our reality. Well, this is the reality of where we find Paul and Barnabas in Acts chapter. No, yes, Barnabas. It was Barnabas, wasn't it? Sorry. Paul and Barnabas in Acts chapter 14. So Acts chapter 14, just to give it a tiny bit of context, Paul and Barnabas are on what we would know as Paul's first missionary journey. Paul did a few. And Barnabas did one with him, and then he did some without him because there was a bit of a fallout. We won't talk about that today. They made it up in the end. That's the good bit of the story. But in Acts chapter 14, they're on this missionary journey, and we find them in Iconium and Lystra and Derbe. And in this chapter, and if you've got your Bibles and you want to turn to it, please feel free to do so. I'm going to kind of go through the text this morning a little bit. In this chapter, we see, I would like to suggest to you a picture or perhaps an idea of some ways in which you and I can be good news sharers today. So what I am hoping to do this morning is to walk us through this chapter and to give us some tools that we can use as we, followers of Jesus today, think about just telling other people about the truth that we have learned for ourselves. And I've got four things that I want to say, four words. My first word is the words. We can use our words. Secondly, presence. Thirdly, action. And finally, humility. Words, presence, action, and humility. So Acts chapter 14, thank you for reading it so well for us, Jill. What translation was it? It wasn't the NIV, was it? Was it the New Living? It was slightly different, but that's good. Yeah. So it was good because that makes us think a bit more. We can get a bit, you know, if we know the verses and we've read them before in a particular translation, we can get used to them, can't we? So it made us kind of think again. In chapter 14, verses 1-3, we read these words, that Iconium, Paul and Barnabas, went as usual into the Jewish synagogue. There they spoke so effectively that a great number of Jews and Gentiles believed. But the Jews who refused to believe stirred up the Gentiles, poisoned their minds against the brothers. So Paul and Barnabas spent considerable time there, speaking boldly for the Lord, who confirmed the message of his grace by enabling them to do miraculous signs and wonders. Paul and Barnabas spoke. Now, the technology has been good so far, and I'm hoping it's going to remain good. Can we have the tiny little video clip that I'd like to show, please?
If I should die, think only this of me. that there's some corner of a foreign field that is forever England. And there shall be in that rich earth a richer dust concealed, a dust whom England bore, shaped, made aware, gave once her flowers to love, her ways to roam, a body of England's, breathing English air, washed by the rivers, blessed by sons of home. And think, this heart, all evil shed away, a pulse in the eternal mind, no less give somewhere back the thoughts by England given, her sights and sounds, dreams, happy as her day, and laughter learnt of friends, and gentleness in hearts at peace under an English heaven.
Very powerful words. One of the most important tools that God has given us to share the good news is our words. I guess in that clip just now, we've just experienced together some quite powerful words. I quite like poetry. Rupert Brooke, yeah, you knew that was Rupert. Of course you all knew. You're all intelligent, clever people, aren't you? So you knew who it was straight away. Powerful words of poetry. And I guess as we came to those words, as we listened to those words, we all experienced them in different ways, didn't we, this morning? I guess we would all react to them in a different way. For us, as we speak about Jesus, I believe that our words can be powerful. Our words can be transformational. Not because they're clever, like the ones we've just heard on the screen. Our words can be powerful. Our words can be transformational when we allow the Holy Spirit to empower what we are saying. Paul told the church in Thessalonica, he said this, that when he spoke to them, he spoke the words that the Holy Spirit had given him to speak. So I reckon if Paul needs that, then you and I definitely need that, yeah? Yeah? Are you awake? It is warm in here, I know, but try and stay awake just for another half an hour. No, I won't talk that long, I promise. You know, when Paul and Barnabas spoke, when Paul and Barnabas spoke in Iconium, they did so boldly. Why? Because they had the power of the Holy Spirit speaking with them. So here, I would suggest we today have something to learn. You know, the words that we speak about Jesus can make a difference to the lives and the people that we talk to if we allow the Holy Spirit to help us and to guide us and to lead us. If you think about the book of Acts, the whole of the book of Acts, what you see in that early church, we read again and again those followers speaking boldly about Jesus, not in their own strength, but through the strength and the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit empowered their words, and that's what made the difference. That is what was transformational. Now, I don't know how you feel about that, but I think that's quite a good thing. I'm glad that it's not my words that make the difference, because my words are pretty weak. My words are pretty average. I hope that you recognize that it's good that it's not your words that make the difference without the Holy Spirit making that difference within you and with you. Because the truth is, I'm not a Rupert Brooke, and I'm guessing none of you are either. You're just normal folks. We're just normal people, aren't we? But us normal people, empowered by the Holy Spirit, can speak words that can make a change, that can make a difference, that can bring transformation. So if you're a Christian, you have words of good news. That's the truth. Your story, the difference that Jesus has made in your life, is good news. You know, and you have the ability to speak those words that can bring transformation, that can make a difference in the lives of people, if and when you allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through you. So as we use our words to talk about Jesus, as we use our words to speak about Jesus, let's be people like Paul and Barnabas. Let's be people who don't speak in our own strength, but allow the Holy Spirit to empower us as we tell people the difference that Jesus has made in our lives. So my first word is the word words. My second word is presence. In Acts 14, verses 2 and the first part of 3, we read that Paul and Barnabas ended up spending a long time in the place where they found themselves. As I was reading the words this week, it kind of made me think, I wonder what would have happened if the Jews had not stirred up trouble. I wonder, would Paul and Barnabas have stayed around as long as they did if the Jews hadn't stirred up trouble? Would they have gone to Lystra sooner? Well, we don't know the answer to those questions, but what we do know is that because of what happened, because of the opposition that they faced, more time was needed to share the gospel in this situation. So as a result of that negative influence of the Jews and the Gentiles, Paul and Barnabas spent considerable time there. We don't even know what that means, do we? Considerable? A week? A month? A year? What's considerable to you might be different to me, but spent considerable time there speaking boldly for the Lord. What I think we need to understand from this, what we need to learn from this for ourselves today, is that we should never underestimate the power of our presence with other people. You know, being with people, being with a person under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit can have and make a profound difference. So if you want to share the good news about Jesus with people, be committed to the people that you want to share that good news with. Considerable time. Considerable a day. It might be a bit more. Is it a year? Could be a bit longer. Who knows? But you need to be committed. You need to be committed. Let me offer you some names this morning. Some people you may have heard of, some people you may not have heard of. You ought to go and find out about all of them because they are incredible people. Richard Allen, Hudson Taylor, Amy Carmichael, Maudie K.I. Johnson, Eric Liddell. Now, just as a very brief aside, if you go and find out about Eric Liddell, there's an absolutely amazing video. It's either on Netflix or Prime. I'm sorry if you don't have those things. It's not the Chariots of Fire. It's the next bit of his life. It's so worth a watch. But have your tissues at the ready. I was bawling. Absolutely. You know, those names of those people that I've just offered to you this morning, do you know what they had in common? God called them to people and they went. And they spent considerable time with the people that God had called them to, sharing the good news, sharing the truth of the gospel that they knew for themselves. So what about us this morning? Well, look, I'd like to suggest to you that our mission field is Broadmead Baptist Church. Our mission field is East. Do we class this as East London? North? Is it East? East, North, North, East? It's around there, isn't it? I ought to know. I only live down the road, for goodness sake. Our mission field is the communities where God has placed us and set us. So, my question to us this morning is, are we being with the people that God is leading us to? You know, are we the people that other people can count on when things are difficult? Are you the one that person will say, I can go and talk to such and such because I know? Yes, the question I want to ask us this morning is, are we willing to enter into their world, whoever they might be? Or do we always expect them to come to us? You see, Paul and Barnabas gave the people at Iconium significant time. They were willing to spend a considerable amount of time with those people. They were willing, in a sense, to get into their world and be part of their world so that they had the time and the ability to share the good news that they knew for themselves. So my second word for us this morning is the word presence. My third word is action. 14:3-10. I'm going to read it. The Lord confirmed the message to his grace by enabling them to do miraculous signs and wonders. The people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews, others with the apostles. There was a plot afoot. That's a good word, isn't it? There was a plot afoot among the Gentiles and Jews, together with their leaders, to mistreat them and to stone them. But they found out about it and fled to the Lycaonian cities of Lystra and Derbe and to the surrounding countryside, where they continued to preach the good news. In Lystra, there sat a man crippled in his feet, who was lame from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul as he was speaking. Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed, and cried out, "Stand up on your feet." At that, the man jumped up and began to walk. Two different settings to, I think, explain one simple point. Paul and Barnabas didn't just speak. Paul and Barnabas were not just with the people, they also acted. They did something. Now, in both these settings that we see, the action actually was miraculous signs performed by the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, God was at work through Paul and Barnabas, and that action in this particular context was the performing of miraculous signs. You know, these miraculous signs, I'm sure, helped those people that they were talking to recognize that Jesus was real. In a sense, the miraculous in this context helped those people to see that God could make a miraculous difference in their lives. I believe that God can still work miracles today. I believe that to be true. I believe we serve a God of miracles today. And sometimes he works miracles in a similar way to perhaps the context that we read here in Acts chapter 14. However, for us this morning, I'd like to try and just suggest that maybe we can broaden our vision of what this might actually look like for us today as well. So let me ask you a question. What miraculous, in the broader sense of the word action, can you perform as you share this good news that we are talking about this morning? Or let me put it a slightly different way, maybe to help you. How might God work through us so that other people can see that Jesus is real? How might you show the truth that God is real to those people that you are coming into contact with, that he is miraculous, that he can make a difference in their lives? I'm not giving the answer this morning. I'm posing the question. You need to go away and think about it for yourself. Because it will be different for each one of us, won't it? My question to you this morning, I guess, ultimately is, what action is God calling you to perform as you share the good news that you know for yourself? Action. My fourth word is the word humility. Now, at the end of the chapter, there's this long bit of the story where the people think the gods have appeared because of the miraculous signs that took place. And the people want to start to worship Paul and Barnabas, and they want to sacrifice the bulls, and all that kind of stuff is going on. I've never had anybody worship me. In fact, I think it's a bit bizarre. Not even my wife and my children. I think it's a bit strange. You know, I know if, like, Charles was brought up to do this, but people bowing to you, it seems a bit odd to me. However, I have had people on more than one occasion that have said things to me that make me think more about myself than I probably ought to. And I guess if we're truthful, That's the reality for all of us. Pride is a dangerous thing. Pride has the potential to ruin you. You know, if we think about a story in the Old Testament, King Saul, the first king of Israel, we see at the start of the story of his life, when he was first king, he was humble. He said, "I can't do this. I'm not capable. I'm not able." All of that stuff. However, later in his life, we see that he disobeyed God. He went his own way and he did his own thing. He thought he knew better than God, basically. He was proud. Now, of course, we know the result of that story. Well, many of us probably do. And if you don't, go and read it for yourself. But the result of that story was that he lost his relationship with God and a new king was found. In our Bible reading this morning, Barnabas and Paul did everything they could to bring honor and glory to God and not take it for themselves. In a sense, they refused to be put on this pedestal that the people there wanted them to. They wanted to put them on the pedestal and they said, no, this is not about us. This is about him. Our Bible clearly teaches us that God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. When Jesus was on earth, he clearly told his disciples that service was the greatest thing you can do in the kingdom of God. So this is not about going, hey, look at me. Actually, the opposite is the truth. We then today, we are called to be humble servants in everything that we do for him, including humble servants when we share the good news that we know for ourselves. We need to be humble. We need to be obedient, doing what Jesus has asked us to do. You know, we aren't the ones who are called to build the church. Jesus didn't say, Lee, you will build my church, or Brian, you will build my church, or Shada, you will build my church. Let's be grateful for all those things, by the way. Let's be grateful that he said, I will build my church. You know what we're called to do? We are called to simply tell, be, act with humility. So my fourth word for us this morning is that word, humility. Hopefully I'm bringing us into land. So we are called to communicate the good news about Jesus. However, we need to recognize that we can't do that on our own. We can't do that on our own. We're not capable. We need God's help. We need the promised Holy Spirit to help us to do this thing that we are called to do. You know, we need the Holy Spirit to empower our words. Our words alone are not enough, but our words with the Holy Spirit's power, that is enough. We need the Holy Spirit as we spend time with those people that God has called us to be with. Purposefully being with people with the help of the Holy Spirit can bring transformation. And we need the Holy Spirit leading us in our actions. Now, this is not just doing stuff. Anybody can do stuff. No, this is more than that. This is about showing the good news in what we do with the help of the Holy Spirit. And finally, we need the Holy Spirit with us so that we will stay humble, so that when we see successes, so that when things go well, and sometimes they do, and praise the Lord, it's Baptism Sunday next week. I was a bit offended that Brian thought that was more important than me being here, but hey, we'll let that go. Praise the Lord for those good moments, but let's recognize it's not about us, it's about him. We need to stay humble. So, for us today, we need to be people committed to speaking, being, doing the good news in all humility. This truth that we have learned for ourselves, if you're a Christian, this transformation that you know for yourself in your own life, we need to communicate that in the ways that I have said, making sure that we always stay humble, because we need the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us in this stuff. We can't do it on our own. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, I thank you for this picture that we see in this chapter from Acts. Lord, I thank you that this verse, this chapter helps us to see perhaps ways in which we can be good news sharers ourselves. Lord, I thank you for the witness of this church over many years, Lord. And Lord, we pray for the witness of this church as we go into the future, Lord. We pray that your word will be spoken. that we will be people of presence where you send us to, that we will be people of action, that we will do all of those things in humility with the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, and we do that not so that we can say, hey, look how good we are, what a wonderful church we are. We do that, Lord God, because we recognize you have called us to be good news sharers. And we want to see that truth of transformation that we know for ourselves in the lives of those people that we meet and come into contact with. So Lord, help us to learn from this chapter. And may we go into this week resolved to share the good news, the difference that you have made in our life with the people that we come into contact with. In Jesus' name we pray. We're going to stand and sing our final song together, Hosanna, Hosanna. So let's stand together and sing together, shall we, please? Well, it's been great to be with you this morning. God bless you. Thank you for suffering with us early on with the technology. Thanks to the tech guys for sorting all that out. You are a star. We only ever notice you when things don't go well. So guys, thank you for all you do. It's much appreciated. As we draw to a close, please do stay for tea and coffee in just a moment, which is served. Is it the hatch over there? Is that, you all know, I don't know. I did notice there was chocolate in the kitchen, though, which seems like a good thing to me. I don't know, but let's share in the words of the grace together. They might be on the screen, but we know them anyway, don't we? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. God bless you, everybody. Have a wonderful day. God bless you. Thank you.